Ladies and gentlemen, as you have now heard, I was the younger. Now I am the older. Therefore, this is terrible. Well, tout d'abord, Monsieur l'Ambassadeur, je souhaite vous exprimer ma reconnaissance parce que je pense que c'est très sage, et vous êtes un homme de sagesse, d'avoir accordé votre soutien à cette réunion et à cette NET of Institute of Advanced Studies, because at this moment, we need more than ever in the past, more than ever. And now with urgency, we need to study the present situation and to be advanced in order to rapidly try to counteract the present trends. The present trends are really a threat for the humanity as a whole, and it's for this reason that I consider that your presence here today and your work and your prospects are very important, and it's for the reason that when the rector told me that he would like that I am this morning here with you, Mr. Ambassador, and with all of you that have been in the leadership of this international movement of Institute of Advanced Studies, I said yes, because it's the only authority that, because of my age now, I respect, you know. And when he tells me, you must do this immediately. Because 40 years ago, more than 40 years ago, I was already working in the Autonomous University. At this moment was at the beginning, because represented in this context a complete way of going out of the, you can imagine what was 40 years ago, the context, the Spanish society and education and science movement. And for this, I was very close with one Nobel laureate, Spanish Nobel laureate, very, very important person, not only as a scientist, that was Professor Severo Ochoa. And, you know, the lessons that I learned at this moment were extremely relevant because I repeat, was a moment in which we should invent the future for this university. And today, the Center of Molecular Biology has more than, with the present situation, you can imagine, more than 600 persons working in this very important institute, in which, and this I would like to underline from the very beginning, in which I learned one thing that is now particularly relevant, and I would like to underline from the very beginning of this contribution, is the irreversible processes. I was working from the very beginning, because I have started when I was in the University of Granada, the diagnosis and treatment, and timely treatment of some diseases that in the newborn, if we immediately after the birth, we can diagnose, because during the pregnancy is the mother who protects the child. But after the moment of the birth, in autonomous life, this disease immediately can start to develop, and the irreversible effect on the neuronal functioning is irreversible. This is what is terrible. That are completely normal children, but they have this disease. This they have lack of one enzyme, etc. Well, I am not going to enter in. But what really matters is that if we make the diagnosis and the treatment, complete normal life. At this moment, I was telling this to the, because his wife has already contributed to this. We have already in Spain at least 6,000 persons are completely normal, when otherwise, without this diagnosis and this immediate treatment, they will be completely, I repeat, and disabled persons in the world. Therefore, irreversible processes. We must have now this very permanently in the horizon of our International Advanced Institute, because otherwise, if we have already some diagnosis, but we have not the immediate treatments, then the reversible situations will arrive. And we must, from the very beginning, therefore, say, yes, we are now with the scientific progress, extraordinary scientific progress. We must put immediately the design of the person, each person. What we have now is not only a group of with the peoples, as it is said so beautifully in the first phrase of the UN Charter. We have with the peoples. But we must now realize that, yes, that with the peoples, every single people is different. Every human being is unique in every moment of his or her life, is a unique human being from the biological and from the cultural point of view. And therefore, we must take this into account, that this diversity that ends in the unicity, because I repeat, every human being is unique, and is able to think, is able to imagine, is able to anticipate, is able to innovate, is able to create. Every single human being is able to create. This is our hope. Because we are not dealing with persons that must go always and thinking and being dogmatic and being supremacist and being fanatic. No. This is precisely the diseases, the social disease that we have, that at this moment starts in Europe also. It's very worrying what is happening again, because we are having already persons that said that our ethnia or our color of the skin or our, what is this? And we cannot say America first, because this is very, very wrong, because all the human beings are equal in dignity. This is one of the ways by which I consider that to talk about human rights and about the force of the reason is very important, but we must know that until now, the reason of the force has always finally been first. Then we can talk, we can say, well, yes, now we have this, with this knowledge, we have this kind of new solutions, but always finally, si vis pacem, para bellum. We must take this into account, because sometimes we are, as a scientist or what is a biological or social scientist, we are knowing that we have perhaps at least the provisional solutions to deal with the different problems, but what happened really? That immediately they say, no, we are sorry, si vis pacem para bellum. Yes, but we want to talk, we want to say si vis pacem para verbum. Para verbum, the word. We must substitute the force by the encounter, by the conciliation, by the negotiation, but the mediation, this is important. But however, we know that immediately we will have no. And I would very much like at the start of this contribution to you, to this meeting, to tell you, be careful. Be careful, because normally we are always talking about what is feasible, what can be the solutions, but immediately we must say to whom we are now talking, in fact. When the President Wilson, in the now 100 years ago, it has been a very nice meeting, by the way, in Paris, with President Macron, that said exactly what must be said now, that we need to reinforce the multilateralism. But what happened? Mr. Trump do not went to the afternoon meeting to talk about peace, because they did exactly the same thing that 100 years ago they did. Mr. Wilson, the President Wilson, suggested after the end of the First World War, said, now we are going to create the League of Nations, the Society of Nations, the League of Nations. And from now on, we will be able to control that Germany do not make rearmament in Germany, and that therefore we can now, through diplomacy, through the mediation, we can solve the problem that will happen. Immediately, as you know, Wilson was separated of the power, and the Republican Party of United States said, no, we are not going to belong to the society that was created by North America. Therefore, this must be known, and this must be in the schools, I think, even in the universities should be dealt about this. How you can imagine that the most important country of the world that creates for diplomacy and for the world the Society of Nations, afterwards do not belong to the Society of Nations. Therefore, the Society of Nations were very weak. And what happens? What happens that in 1933, one person very well known, that was a German with a very big well-known mustache, he said that in his book, Mein Kampf, he said that the Aryans are, with a supremacist point of view, the Aryans are incompatible with the Jewish and with other ethnies. And this was the reason why immediately Mussolini said exactly the same thing, oh, with the Romans, and that also we must not forget that in the very East countries, one Japanese emperor, Hirohito, said exactly the same thing, we are superior. What happens? A terrible Second World War. And at the end of this terrible Second World War, a very wise president of the United States, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, make a wonderful design for the future. And he said, we the peoples, because this I would very much like to remember, we the peoples, we have resolved to save the succeeding generations from the scourge of the war. Fantastic. Now we must say, now, today, we must say, we the peoples, we have decided to save the succeeding generations for the lack of human life quality that can follow if we do not stop the present trends. And this is what now we must say, we the peoples. But when Roosevelt said this, immediately, as you know, he died very soon because he was with leukemia, but he said to his wife, we need some guidance for this organization. One organization that had one institution for health, one institution for food, one institution for the children, one fund, the UNICEF, one institution. They have a very wonderful design for the future. But he said, we need some points of reference from the value point of view, from the social point of view. And then he asked her Eleanor, to go with this, and with René Cassin, with Stefan Hessel, they wrote this wonderful Declaration of Universal Declaration of Human Rights that start saying that all human beings, and this is, I think that today what we must really try to all human beings are equal in dignity and they are free. And they're free. And this was based, by the way, in one document that I recommend you as former Director General of UNESCO, that is the preamble and the first article of this, the Constitution of UNESCO is really a very wise recommendation for the future. Why? Because this was written in a moment of a terrible human tension. After this terrible war, you can imagine those that were written, Archibald Magillis, René Cassin, all these people that was already trying to say the world, we must learn the lessons of this terrible war that now has ended. And what they say, the humanity must be guided by the democratic principles. Democratic principles, please, do not talk, we are telling you today, democracy, democracy. And we say that democracy is to have elections and to have sometimes elections that are completely manipulated because of this immense mediatic power and all these things. No, no. What they say here, this is a wise document. They say democratic principles of the human dignity, equality, mutual respect, intellectual and moral solidarity, and freedom. These are the democratic principles. This is what now we must try to tell the world, that this is democracy, and that what we need is to really try to reinforce and to perhaps refund the United Nations system. Because what has happened in the decade of the 80s? What happened? After this terrible, was the race, you remember, the armament race between the two superpowers, the United States and Soviet Union. This was always in this. But in a given moment, something happened. It was in the decade of the 80s. And at this moment, I thought, I can tell you very, I said, oh, no. Now, yes, now can be feasible, because the what was absolutely unattended, because was impossible to imagine that in South Africa, a man, after 27 years of prison, only because his color of skin, Nelson Mandela, you remember that in 7 months, he was able to completely change. And against the most abominable form of fanaticism and racism, that was the racial apartheid, he was able not only to overcome all this, but to become president of South Africa. What a wonder. And all this, with one person like this, we can now, because impossibles today are realities. Therefore, are things that are possible today, and until now we were saying, no, this is impossible. Another impossible that I was very close to him was, is still alive, ill, but still alive, was Mikhail Gorbachev. Mikhail Gorbachev was a person that after Brezhnev, Andropov, Chernenko, he arrived and he changed immediately. And I was with him when the meetings in October 1986 with President Reagan. And of course we said, what a pity that Mr. Reagan and Madame Thatcher at this moment there were with all these stupid things saying that, oh, now we are, because what when Mr. Reagan was talking about the Star Wars, Mr. Gorbachev answered, for me what worries me is starvation. Because we today, we are saying, no, because we have, we must defend, we must expend more money in defense, Europe must defend. You know how many people will die today of hunger? At least 20,000 persons, most of them children from 1 to 5 years old. And this is what happens. This is the reality that we had at this moment that we have now. But this doesn't win. But this is the war, the real war that we have every day. We are investing $4 billion per day in military expenditures. We need a new concept of security. Because always now, when we talk about defense, is the defense of the frontiers, the defense of the territories. And what happens about what the people that are living in these territories? There are five priorities in the United Nations system. The first is food. The second is water. The third is health. The fourth is environment care. And the fifth, very important, is education. And education for all throughout life, because we are always talking about education, thinking in the children. No. Starting with those that are in the government, these are what must be educated, because if we educate the children, but those that are in the, no. And in UNESCO, again, I tell you, that is in the article number one, they say what is an educated person. And they say, one educated person are those that are free and responsible. Then This is exactly what your institutes try to do, to be free, every human being free, without dogmatism, without supremacism, without, and at the same time be responsible, thinking in the generations to come. It's for this that I think that we the peoples, we have resolved to take into account the succeeding generations, and therefore not to follow the present trends. The present trends are the present trends that can, in 20 or 25 years, really be in a world framework in which there will be no more hope for example, I do not tell you now reestablishing the environmental conditions from 20 or 100 years ago, but at least we can moderate and we can adapt to all this. But otherwise, really, we can have a very, very intergenerational legacy that can be a disaster. And it's for this reason that I consider that we must now tell to Mr. Reagan and Madame Thatcher to say, you are plutocratic groups, this G6, G7, G8, G20, we are now fed up with this. We must now to tell you that this has been a disaster, because once more has been the reason of the force against the force of the reason. And how can we accept it, that six countries at the beginning was a G6. In fact, it's the G1, but well, it's the same. But they say G6, then Canada, G7, then Russian Federation, G8, then in the moment of the crisis, now we can, G20. But what is this? 6, 7, 8, 20 countries having in their hands the reins of our common future. What is this? If we are 196 countries, we must be these 196 countries all together, because today we must be all together. And we must try all together to find solutions for the world. And we must try not only to have the diagnosis, as I said before, we must have the treatments, effective treatments that must be applied. Because otherwise we can say, oh yes, we had the solution, but we were unable to implement them. I can tell you one thing. During this period, of course, Ambassador Turrit, in 1949, as I did, Albert Camus was not permitted in Spain, you can imagine, no? But, well, clandestinity is also sometimes a very attractive thing, because in this way you do things that perhaps otherwise you will not do well. And I was reading Albert Camus, and at the end of one of his books, is terrible, because he says, je vous méprise parce que vous pouvez, mais vous n'avez pas osé. I disregard you because you were able to do things and you have not dared. To dare. I think that is very important. When I was coming to you to Oxford to work with Professor Krebs, I saw that in the English are like this, you know. They put in their emblems, they do not put never things in English. They put in Latin or in French, as you know. But in this case was sapere aude, no, dare to know. And I was, I said, oh, this is very, very wise. Yes, we must dare to know. But when I was leaving, I said, it's very important to dare to know if after you are able to know how to dare. Because otherwise, you know the solutions, but you have not the resolution in a given moment to say, yes, now we must act in this way. This is what I consider that now we can. In the moment in which Roosevelt wrote with the peoples, this was not feasible. Because, I repeat, 90% of the peoples of the world in Spain, and today still in many countries, 90% of the people were living, being born, and dying in some square kilometers. And they were unaware of what was happening. they were completely persons that were following the informations that were only at local level. But this was not, this was my case when I was young. I mean, we were unable to. And it's for this that the first paragraph of the preamble of the Declaration of Human Rights say this human rights is for to save the humanity from fear. Because we were fearful, we were silent, we were obedient, we were submitted, yes, because we were only in our we were unaware of what's happening in the world, we were unable to speak, we were silent. And then it's very important that the first paragraph says, no, no, this is to save you from this fear. But the second paragraph is even more important. In the second paragraph, Ambassador says, if you cannot exercise fully the human rights, you must rebel. Rebellion, not revolution. Eh? They say rebellion. But yes, we must say, now, no. Now, the solution is that the intellectuals, the universities, the scientist community, the artistic community, because what we need is more philosophy. What we need today is more social science than ever. In order to say, yes, what we must protect is every single human being, because every human being is able to create, is able to make a personal design of his future. But what happens? We have an immense mediatic power. We have an immense mediatic power that today, and well, I like to say what is the reality. In this moment in Spain, 80% of the media say what they are imposed to say. They do not say what is happening in the world. They are, I remember when I was a young person, there were was at this moment were discos, no? But como se llamaban?
Long play.
Sí,
play.
Exactly. And they said, his master voice. Today, my dear friends, most of the media are his master voice. And we must now say, no, no. Now you must have the voice of the advanced studies. You must have now the voice of those that know what must be done, and what we must do is to say now, yes, now we the peoples, we can. Now we can, because from some years ago, and in some extent because of the digital technology, now we know what happens. Now we can express ourselves. We can utilize the WhatsApps, we can say, I love you very much, and we can meet. But we can also utilize this to say, Mr. Trump, no. If you do not put into practice the Paris Agreement or the Sustainable Development Goals, we will not buy anymore United States products, for example. I mean, now it's with the peoples that we must take decisions, because otherwise we have nothing to do. You can imagine, and at this respect, France did an excellent work in the signing in the year 2015 in Paris of the agreement. It is true that at this moment Obama was a president that was very much in favor, and he was able to convince also Mr. Xi of China. But this moment was great, and for me was, I said, now we have ended. And this in Paris, when also was approved in the year 1984, the 48, the Declaration of Human Rights. I was so happy. And afterwards, the resolution in the General Assembly to transform the world. This is the first time that this Agenda 2030 says is to transform the world. And all this is signed by many countries at the United Nations. And they said, oh, what a wonder. Now we have the agreements of Paris, we have the agenda, we are going to transform the world. And then arrived Mr. Trump and said, I will not apply. What is this? You cannot say this. And it should be the capacity of the European Union to say, no, Because in a given moment, they had this capacity. For example, when Mr. Chirac was the president of France, he did not follow the absurd decision of Mr. Bush Jr. of invading Iraq, based on lying, based on nothing that was, because I was very good friend of the head of the inspectors and I know very well what happened. And he said, no. He said, I am unable to master the technology, you know, and it's for the reason that. But Mr. Chirac made a fantastic, well, the representative of Mr. Chirac. I say, at this moment, there were some leaders in Europe that were able to say no. Now, this leadership is not existent, or now perhaps start to talk about multilateralism, etc. In summary, my dear friends, I must end. I think that now we have, for the first time in history, the possibility of talking about with the peoples. In 1945, this was premature. Now we know what happens. Now we are able to raise our voice, because we have already our voice, every of us. And most important of all of this is the women. You can imagine, I am an old person, as I said at the beginning. Here are so many women, what a wonder. When I think now back, 40 years ago and 50, was nothing. For example, at the beginning in my lab, I had 12 men and only 2 women. By the way, one of these women, to her I said, now, all the project concerning the diagnosis of neonatal metabolic disease is for you. And I had many colleagues of mine that were, Professor Mayor, it is true that you are going to give a so important project to a woman? This is to tell you what was at this moment the context. Well, now these things have changed. And I would like to end, because for me it was very important in my life. In the year 1996, as Director General of UNESCO, I went to see President Mandela. I was already a very good friend of him, because I went when he was still as a prisoner in Robben Island, in the Snake Island, close to Cape Town. And I told him, President, I am very worried, because I thought that the Culture of Peace Initiative will have more strength and will be more supported. And I think that, and he told me, don't worry, you must wait some 10 or 15 years, because women, he said, will be the cornerstone of the new era. We will enter in the new era, they want or not, because we are going to be present in very difficult moments and in a new era in which finally we will have the force of the reason and not the reason of the force. And the women will be the cornerstone of this new era. And I look at him saying, why? And he said to me something that is absolutely true. He said, because women only exceptionally utilize this force, and men only exceptionally do not. therefore, now that we can, because we can know what happens, we can, with the peoples, now we can say that things must change, and must change in this way, and we can say no to Mr. Trump, etc., etc. Now is a moment in which I consider that your studies can not only be a good diagnosis and be very important for the future, but can go with timely treatments in order that we can correct and reconduct and redress the present trends. Many thanks.
Some questions to Federico Mayor. If not, we can proceed to the next session. Thank you very much to all of you.